Hello, my name is David Wojciechowski. I'm a transplant nephrologist and the medical director of the kidney transplant program here at UT Southwestern Medical Center. Today I'm going to spend the next few minutes speaking with you about the different types of deceased donor options that you have available as a potential transplant recipient. So as you know, when you're listed for transplant, there are many different types of deceased donors that are potentially available. They fall into many different categories, which are listed on this slide, and we're going to go through each of these categories in a little bit more detail over the subsequent slides. The first type of deceased donor that we'll talk about is what's called a high KDPI donor. KDPI stands for the Kidney Donor Profile Index, and it's based on the characteristics of the donor at the time of their death. Different factors go into this calculation that give the score of 0 to 100. Any score greater than 85 is considered a high KDPI donor. These kidneys are labeled high KDPI because they're expected to have a shorter graft survival compared to lower KDPI donors. For example, a high KDPI donor may have a history of high blood pressure, or the donor may have had a slightly elevated creatinine at the time of their death. Why would someone want to accept a high KDPI donor? Well, we know that somebody on dialysis has a higher risk of mortality or dying on dialysis while they're waiting for their transplant. So the data suggests that being able to get transplanted faster with a high KDPI kidney, even though it may not be as good of a quality kidney as a lower KDPI, will actually increase your survival and help you live longer compared to staying on dialysis. Now, we don't offer these high KDPI kidneys to everybody. We suggest that patients who are over the age of 60, who have a history of diabetes, or who are over the age of 65, consider taking one of these high KDPI kidneys, as the data suggests that it will increase your survival compared to remaining on dialysis, waiting for a higher quality kidney. Additionally, it's important to remember that kidneys of better quality or lower KDPI scores are actually preferentially allocated to younger patients, particularly pediatric recipients, as well as patients who have fewer comorbid medical conditions compared to patients who would be eligible for high KDPI kidney. When looking at their survival benefit, you can see on this slide that the 5-year survival rate on dialysis is 25 out of 100 people. This is in comparison to those who accept a high KDPI kidney, where the 5-year survival rate after transplant with a high KDPI kidney is 70 out of 100 people. So again, there's a clear benefit in accepting one of these kidneys compared to remaining on dialysis and waiting for a higher quality kidney. The second type of kidney donor that we'll discuss is a donor that has risk criteria for disease transmission according to the Public Health Services, more commonly known as PHS. This is a donor who has a history of behaviors such as IV drug use, recent incarceration, unprofessional tattoos or piercings, sexual behaviors, or unknown medical or social history at the time of their death. This is based on the donor's social history that we can obtain from the patient's family at the time of their death and not based on any obtained lab results. What are the benefits of accepting a PHS risk criteria donor? You may receive a transplant sooner, and you will often receive a higher quality organ when you receive a PHS donor. What are the potential risks? There's a risk of transmission of disease, but that is very low and usually manageable and typically falls far less than 1% in terms of the actual risk. When we think about the risk that you can accrue by accepting a PHS donor, we can look at this slide and you can see that the risk of HIV or hepatitis C from one of these kidneys is incredibly low. It's less than 0.3 out of 100 people. This is a comparison to the risk of dying in a car accident, which is 0.9 out of 100 people. So this tells us that your risk of just driving to a normal appointment or the grocery store is actually higher than accepting one of these PHS kidneys. There are also some other considerations when we're looking at a PHS donor. We want to consider the 5-year mortality risk when accepting or declining one of these offers. What we know is that 20% of patients die while waiting for their kidney transplant, and 19% were removed from the waitlist while waiting, meaning that they were never transplanted nor had the option to be transplanted. This suggests that accepting a PHS donor will shorten your waiting time and improve your survival compared to remaining on dialysis and waiting for a non-PHS donor. Additionally, it's important to remember that a PHS donor is very common. If you look nationally, about 1/3 of all deceased donor transplants fall under this category. So saying no to this category at the time of listing and not being willing to even entertain these offers will actually exclude many donors that are potentially available to you on the deceased donor waiting list. The third type of potential donor falls under the category of hepatitis B core positive or hepatitis C positive. The word hepatitis can sometimes sound scary, but we have to remember that in general, when we offer certain types of kidneys, we always do it in the context of being able to manage the risk. So let's first look at the hepatitis B core positive donor. This is a donor that has a natural history of immunity to hepatitis B and did not require a vaccination. The risk of transmission is less than 2% of acquiring hepatitis B from one of these donors, And if that were to occur, there are actually medications that effectively treat hepatitis B. Additionally, it's important to remember that many of you who are already on dialysis have been vaccinated against hepatitis B. So you actually have immunity against this virus. Therefore, your risk of transmission is even far lower than the 2% that we just quoted. What about a hepatitis C positive donor? For our program, this falls under two categories. The first type are those who are hepatitis C positive in terms of their antibody, but they have no active virus in their blood, meaning they either had the infection and cleared it on their own, or they had the infection and were treated effectively with antiviral therapy, or it's even possibly a false positive test at the time of the donor procurement. In this case, there's almost a 0% risk of acquiring hepatitis C from these donors, and we actually will check you for hepatitis C approximately 1 month after your transplant to ensure that there was no transmission of virus. The last type under this hepatitis category are the hepatitis C positive donors who not only have antibody positive, but they also have virus positive. This means that they are actively infected with hepatitis C. This type of transplant requires an additional consent from you, the patient, noting that you have listened to and understood in more detail the issues associated with this type of deceased donor transplant. In this case, you actually will become positive for hepatitis C, both antibody and virus most likely, but we will actually treat you for hepatitis C approximately 1 to 2 weeks after your transplant. We know that we can cure hepatitis C 99%+ of the time. Therefore, we believe that the risk of remaining on dialysis actually outweighs the risk of receiving one of these kidneys, knowing that we're able to effectively treat the hepatitis C after transplant. As you can see, the risk of acquiring hepatitis C from hepatitis C positive, NAT negative donor is far less than 0.1% out of 100 people. The risk of dying again in a car accident is 0.9 out of 100 people. Again, the risk of things that we do in daily life seem to be higher than some of the risks that are acquired by accepting certain types of organ transplants from deceased donors. The fourth type of transplant that I will discuss is the A2B transplant into a blood type B recipient. So this sounds a little complicated. What does this mean? So as many of you know, when we look at transplant, we do look to match blood type in terms of the donor and the recipient. And in general, we're trying to match the blood type to you. Typically, we're not able to do an A blood type donor into a B blood type recipient. There is, however, one exception. If the blood type B recipient has low titers of antibodies against blood group A, and the donor is the subtype of A2 blood group, we're actually able to do this transplant without any additional medication or preparation. This is possible because the A2 subtype of the A donor is poorly and minimally expressed on the donor kidney. Therefore, there's very little likelihood that the recipient will have a reaction to this donor. Now, we do have certain cutoffs for the antibody levels in the recipient. We do look for these antibodies in any blood group B recipient, and we monitor these on a regular basis to ensure that you are still eligible for this program. But this is another way for a patient who is blood type B, who typically has the longest waiting time in our region, to get transplanted a little bit quicker while they're waiting for their deceased donor transplant. The fifth type of donor that I will talk about is a donor who has passed away after cardiac death. So most organs today are from donors who die of brain death, meaning that the heart is still beating at the time of the organ removal or procurement. In this case, however, the donor has undergone cardiac death and the heart has stopped. The risk that really comes with this donor has nothing to do with infections or any other issues. It's more that the kidney itself may be sleepy at the time of transplantation. We call that delayed graft function. That means the recipient may need a little bit of dialysis for a short period of time after the transplant while we wait for this kidney transplant to perk up or start working. In general, however, 99%+ of these kidneys work just fine and the patient comes off dialysis and has excellent function. And in fact, if you look at the long-term outcomes, there's actually no difference between a donation after cardiac death donor and what we would call a standard or brain dead donor. The last type of donor I will talk about falls under the HOPE Act. The HOPE Act is an act of Congress that was signed by the president a few years ago that actually allows us to utilize HIV positive donors in HIV positive recipients. In order to do this, any center that participates in this type of transplant has to do it under the guise of a clinical research study. At UT Southwestern, we perform our HOPE Act transplants under the guise of the HOPE in Action clinical trial that is sponsored by the National Institutes of Health. If you have HIV, our coordinators will inform the doctors at UT Southwestern, and you may receive an additional phone call after your initial evaluation appointment to discuss the possibility of participating in the HOPE in Action clinical trial. If you decide to participate, you would need to sign a research consent, and this would allow us to offer you organs from deceased donors who are HIV positive. In this case, the main risk would be acquiring a form of HIV that is slightly different than your own and may require a change in your HIV medication regimen. You will also see an infectious disease specialist who is an expert in HIV in order to assess this risk and counsel you further about this possibility. These are the potential types of deceased donors that you could be offered, all of which may be able to shorten your waiting time and get you off dialysis faster. We look forward to seeing you in the future and hopefully, more importantly, seeing you sooner for transplantation.